Hi. Well, it's good to see everyone here this morning. I tell you, we see more and more people every Sunday coming back to church, and we are just so thankful for that, to see the families that have been away because of the virus, and now they've gotten their shots, and they're back ready to get out and come back to church. We're so glad to see everyone here with us.
Amen.
And more and more each week. And we appreciate you so much. So let's take our hymn books now. Turn to hymn number 774, familiar hymn we sing together, "When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder."
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved on earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ arise, and the glory of His resurrection share, when His chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all His wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Amen. Thanks for singing out this morning, Pastor.
Kind of relating to our message for today, Romans 11:33 says, "Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are His judgments and His ways past finding out." That's the God that we serve. And let's open in a word of prayer. Almighty God and our Father in heaven, Lord, today we gather in the name of the Lord. We gather to worship, Lord, because that's what You desire of us, that we truly lift up Your holy name, and that we worship and praise You, that we greet one another with Christian greeting. So I pray, bless this service today. Bless each one that's came, Lord, and we thank You for them. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good morning. Good
morning.
Good to see everybody. I believe we're growing. Last week I said we might have put in a few new pews, but we'll get these filled for long, and then we'll start talking about that. But it is good to see. It really is. And I don't believe I see any visitors. But we do have some that have returned, and thank God for you. We've missed you. It's been a hard year. It's been a long struggle. It's been a trying time for the leaders of the church, but we welcome you and thank you for being here. I'm going to turn it back over to Jim now.
Thank you. It is good to see everyone. And we apologize for last week. We had lots of technical difficulties last week. I was back in the back texting away and doing this and that. But we finally figured out we had an internet problem last week, and we've got that resolved. And so we are back on track, and hopefully everybody can hear us on Facebook and still going out on the radio for those that need to come out into the parking lot and listen and don't feel comfortable coming in. But we're glad that we are back up and running. Just a few announcements. Don't forget your prayer lists, of course, and the bulletins as you come in each Sunday are there on the tables at both entrances for you to get. And then, as we always say each week, remind everyone of the shoebox items that we're gathering for the month of March, and that is small dolls, small stuffed animals, toy trucks and cars, flashlights with extra batteries, small games, puzzles, pads, things like that, and make sure that they do fit, that they would be small enough to fit into a shoebox. Okay, so when you're out shopping around, if you can see those, just bring those and place them in the box in the entryway there as you come in. There will be a short business meeting today after the service, so please remain for that, and we'll keep things short and get everybody out of here still this by, 12:30, 1 o'clock. No, just kidding. But also, Linda is going to have a little word for us here later on in the service, right around the business session time, about the insert that you have there in your bulletin. You can read about that, and then Linda is going to share about that a little later on in the service. All right, let's take our hymn books again. Turn to hymn number 772, another very familiar hymn, When We All Get to Heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Let's continue to worship in song.
Thank you.
news to them singing two songs. I sat there and wait and wait, hoping they'll sing another one. And good to see everyone. We welcome all those on Facebook that you're joining us this morning. We hope you really enjoy our service, and we are here to praise God. That's why we exist as a church, to do just that. Now, I'm going to be speaking from the first epistle of Peter today. And I'll tell you what, the good Lord's been working on me for a while now. So I'm going to do a series on the book of Peter. I don't know if I'll get into the second one also, but we'll just start and see where God leads. And I think that's good. So turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, and we'll read the first 12 verses. So if you'll turn there, then we'll see what God has for us there. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. The Bible says, "Our Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, the stranger scattered through Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein we greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen you love, in whom, though now you see him not, yet believing, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, and when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into." And let us pray. Almighty God, Father, we come to your scripture today. This book means so much to us. It is our guidebook to Christian living and seeking God and knowing what you require of us. And so as we look at this, Father, just open our hearts, our minds, fill us with your Spirit to receive this, and help us just to look and see what you want from us. And we'll praise you for it all. And we ask these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. You know, the Apostle Peter, he is one of the most interesting believers in the Bible. There is just, this man was just so different from the others. He was the leader of the others. He was the apostle. He was the one that Jesus called to ministry. And he was the one that was always up front, always at times saying wrong things, that type of thing. But, you know, we've been caught doing that too. But Peter, God had picked him. Jesus Christ had called him when he was a fisherman. And you remember that from the scripture. He was a fisherman, he and his brother Andrew, and Jesus walked by. Now, this seems strange, doesn't it? But Jesus said, "Come, follow me." Wow. The Bible says they dropped their nets. Now, first meeting, first time, who would just fall into that? Who would say, "Okay, this is over. Now I'm going to go with Jesus"? They had met a man who was also the Lord God. They met him, and he changed their life so drastically He spoke with authority. He had compassion. He was one that loved people. And he loved especially those that would do as Peter did and the others, where he said, come follow me. When God called us, when Jesus prompted us through conviction, and he said unto us, come follow me. It's the same thing. But how do we react to that? Did we drop our net, so to speak, and say, I'm going to follow Jesus? I might have to work jobs. I might have to do this and all. But I'm going to set my course on following Jesus Christ and him only. None other. Because we have to give up so much to follow Jesus. But think about what we gain. We gain a new life, a whole new start in life. And we look to him, and he guides us and leads us. He points out our errors now. He wouldn't be God if he didn't point out our wrongs, would he? But anyway, he called Peter. He spoke to Peter, come follow me. And Peter said, yes, Lord, yes. If that is just what people would do in our day and time, just say, yes, Lord, whatever you're calling me to, whatever you want of me, if you want me to be a missionary in the furthest ends of the world, I say yes. And so what do we do? Do we really approach God in that manner? Because he is serious about his call to us. He's serious about us worshiping and following him. And if we do not, what's our life going to be like? If we truly are saved, if we don't follow him, obey him, our lives are going to be miserable because we know that we have failed God. So the thing that we need to see is this. When he points me in a certain direction, I'm going to say, yes, Lord, I'm going to follow him. If he's going to make of me, whether it be just a church member, which there's always something to do in being a member, but also, what if he calls you to teach Sunday school? What about preaching? What about going on the mission field? What will we say to him? Will we trust him? Will we follow him? Will we receive from him? Now, that's what Peter and Andrew and all the others that he called. And most of those calls were just like that. I mean, they received the call and they went. Is that not obedience? Let me say this. We need to learn obedience to God. Serving God is more important than any other thing that we'll ever do in our lives. Serving him. Saying, yes, Lord. Yes. Lord, you saved me. You've changed my life. Now, what do you want me to do? That's what Peter did. Now, Peter, yeah, he had his mishaps. He denied his Lord. Oh, what a terrible thing we would think about that. But any type of disobedience in our lives is our denying him to be fully and completely in control of our lives. If we will follow him, then he will use us. He will grow us. God didn't mean for Christians to stay baby. Baby Christians. They have to be fed by the milk of the word, but they grow in grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ, and then they receive the meat of the word. And that's having him inside, having him dictating to us, and not we trying to say, well, I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that. The most important thing that we will ever do in our lives, all of us now, is to say yes to God. Lord, yes, you want me to be a Sunday school teacher? Whatever, whatever. To say yes, Lord. You know what so many in our day and time, and I've done it myself, say, I can't. I can't. If God says you can, you can. If God has given us gifts, that we need to use them for the glory of God. That's what he wants of us to do. And we have to do just that to please him. Now, he calls these that he's speaking to, Peter, he's calling them the elect. Now, these are people that have been dispersed by persecution, different things. They were placed in the places he mentions there in verse 1, but he calls them the elect. Now, a lot of people are afraid of that phrase right there. But it explains it right there in that same verse. According to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, elect. He knew us before we were ever even thought about. He knew us. He saw us before the foundation of the earth. And he said, that's one of mine. I'm going to bring him to the point of salvation. Now, does man have any right to say no? Oh, if we are one of God's elect, we best not say no to him. We best receive and we best follow him. And he'll make us useful vessels. He told Peter and the others that were fishermen, I'll make you fishers of men. Well, let me go ahead and say, church, right now, as Christian people, church-going Christian people, he has made us to be fishers of men. Because there's a world out there, it's dying. There's a world that is going to hell, if you will. But God can make a difference, and he will use Christian people. Now, in churches, you have all different spiritual levels of Christians. Start with baby Christians, work up to full serving Christian brothers and sisters. Those that are not afraid to step out for God, for Jesus Christ. That's what he called us to do. Now, the question is this. What will we answer him? Now, this might say, okay, I've heard this many times. But let me ask you something. As Christians, when we stand before him at that judgment seat of Christ, what are we going to say to him if we said, well, I know, but I can't. I can't do that. God says, hey, you know you can't. If I say I've given you a gift in some area, some way, how do you know that you can't? Folks, you can if God says you can. And we need to understand something that God expects us to be connected to one another. We're brothers and we're sisters in Christ. There's no some above others. Now, the gifts differ. But what I'm saying, we're all important to God, to Jesus Christ. So will we step out in faith? Step out. I tell you what, I know in my own life, there are many times I said, I can't do that. I can't do that. But you have to throw that I can't to the wind and get on the road, the straight and narrow, to say, yes, Lord, I'll go where you want me to go and I'll do everything that you want me to do. Now, this was where Peter was really facing Jesus Christ in a way of saying, can I follow him? Can I do what he's asked me to do? Now, I'm going to tell you something about Peter. He wasn't afraid now. He proved that the night they came and took Jesus. He pulled his sword and he cut off the ear of Malchus, servant of the high priest. I believe he had every desire to fight for his Lord, but he was doing it the wrong way. What did Jesus say? Put up your sword. And he healed the ear. But Peter, he had a strong walk forward, if you will call it that, for Jesus Christ. And why do we read this in the Bible? Why do we study this book of Peter? Because we can draw from it. We can receive from it. There is a training thing through this Peter. He had his faults. He failed many times. He denied his Lord. But go all these years later where he wrote this first epistle of Peter. You see a different Peter. How can we use that? We start out as a Christian. As we receive the teaching of the word, as we receive from God that power, that strength, that Holy Spirit anointing us, there is nothing that we cannot do as long as God is in. But don't give God that saying, I can't. He don't want to hear it. What he wants to hear is, yes, Lord, I know you'll give me power to serve in whatever way you've called me. Yes, I want to go. Yes, I want to serve. I want to be what you've called me to be. I want to be what you have given me power to be. Don't deny God. Because if we say we can't when he's already called us, then we have denied our Lord. Because he is the one who gives that power in. So Peter wrote this book in the power and strength of the Spirit of God. See, that's another thing it teaches us. In the power and strength that God gives, we can do it. We can go forward for him. Where did Peter finally end up? He was martyred on a cross, upside down. He did not feel worthy to die, even as his Lord did. That is what a growing Christian can become. See, it's like this. I know we cherish our lives, but what about when we leave this world, or how we leave this world? Is our lives more important in the here and now than they will be when we stand before Jesus Christ in that judgment seat of Christ? That's something to think about, something for all of us to ponder, but we have to trust God. That is the key to it all. We can sing these songs of Zion, and they can sing really nice. They can really pump us up. But what we sing, do we believe? Do we commit ourselves to God? I think we can all say in our hearts, yes, Lord, you are supreme. You are God. You are over all. And I want to believe in you. I want to trust in you. And I want you to send me exactly where you want me to be. What if this very day God would say to you, I'm calling you to be a missionary. He said, whoa, Lord, I've got a job. I've got a family. I've got all of this. But what would God say back? He would say, I can make the provision. I can do in you a great work. And I can supply your need because it's promised. What would we say? We cannot give an argument to God. Because if we're a child, children, they need to obey. And that's what we are. We are children of God. We are those that have said, come into my heart, Lord Jesus, and save me. Now, Peter was one that just, he followed God. Now, Jesus Christ used his boat to preach out of. Wow. Think about that. God gave Peter the boat and ended up being a preaching platform for Jesus. Wow, that's something else. God will use whatever you are, whatever you have, wherever you are, he'll use that for his glory. Do you believe that? I know I do. I do. He's proved that to me many times. So we have to be ready, willing, and wait. Now, Peter speaks of the elect. And if you're here today and you truly know Jesus Christ, let me go ahead and tell you, you were elected before the foundation of the earth. The foreknowledge of God. Now, a lot of people don't believe that. But who are we? We're only flesh and blood. I couldn't call the shots for myself. God called those. He gave me a stamp of approval. Especially when I came to Christ and received salvation. But long before I was ever thought of, before this world was ever built, God called me. God says he's one of ours. He said that to you if you know him. He's one of ours. See, God elects, but he leaves a choice with us. Will I believe him? Will I trust him? Will I? God says, yes, I've chosen you. And you will. But I want you to make a decision right here and now. I'm speaking to the church, too. Come follow me. That decision that he gives, the option to us to become a Christian. And also to obey. We have to look to him. We have to trust in him. We have to serve him. with all our hearts, soul, mind, and strength. Now, the elect cannot just be for Jews. Now, these Peter is speaking to, they are Jews, scattered. But he also brought salvation to the whosoever will. Jew, Gentile, whoever. The word goes out. Will people answer? When God calls, will they answer? But they are the chosen ones. Wow. And you know what? God never meant for any man to go to hell. Because of John 3:16 proves that. For God so loved the world. That's each and every one's ever been born into this world. He loved them. And he loves them. But what will he do with disobedient people? The ones that he has brought into this world. What will he do? Will he just say, that's okay? He had to teach Peter. Peter had to go through some hard things. I tell you what, there's some verses in this section that I really like because they relate to me. Like verse 7. That the trial of your faith, Christian, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Do you have trouble in your life? I think sometimes in our life we'll all have trouble. There will be those times that we feel so down, so out. Lord, where are you? You know why the trials exist? To grow us as Christians. We are to suffer in the name of Jesus, and we are to look for his hand to help us, to guide us, to make us stronger, grow us into powerful Christians. If Peter and all the apostles, except Judas, if they died martyred deaths, where does that leave us? We say, oh no, I've got to live a good life. I mean, I got to make a big bank account. I've got to do all this. How do you know even what your tomorrow will be like? We don't know. None of us do. So why, while today is in existence, why not make a decision? God, I'll follow you. We sing that song sometimes. Wherever he leads, I'll follow. Do we mean that? Will we say yes to him in that? So we have to see it in that way. You know what the big difference between us and God is? He knows who will follow and who won't. He knows who will be saved and who won't. He already knows. But we prove it out when we say yes to God. Yes, Lord, guide me in a path that's going to bring glory and honor to you and your name. Verse 6, or he says, wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be. That little phrase right there really stuck with me this whole week. If need be. Now, what could that mean? If he's saying, you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptation. I think that has to say about us, about our surrender to him. But if we won't, he allows those trials to come in our lives, if need be. What? To bring us to himself, to grow us into useful vessels and people that will say, I want to tell you about my Jesus. I want to tell you about my God. What a powerful, wonderful God he really is. But if need be, you know, I've seen those need be's. I have felt those need be's. And they are. They're for our good. They are for our growth, our maturing as Christians. And we have to understand, folks, all the goodness that we say I've got in this life, I've bought houses, I've bought all of this. Look, those things will be destroyed. There'll be no K carrying them to heaven with us. You go up there and you see what God is, Christian, what he has made for you, prepared for you. Are you going to say, oh, I had better than that on earth? God says, I am blessing you. Just look outside. There's a street of gold going up by your place that I have prepared for you. There is greatness. There are loved ones. There's no sin in heaven. There's no way that man can be against anything that God has designed. Now, he's speaking to our hearts. I feel it in my own heart, even right now. We need to say, yes, Lord, I know my failures. I ask you to forgive, and I ask you, the Holy Spirit of God, just to direct my path and show me the right way. Help me not to lead to one side or the other. Straight and narrow. Follow him. If we'll do that, he'll bless. Yes, we may have to go through hard times. Yes, I've seen them in my life. I saw my parents' life. They suffered many ways. God did not intend for us as Christians to have a bed of roses. He never was his intent. But when you compare these few little years down here to the glory of God's heaven, that place he prepared, when we're in the presence of Jesus Christ, think about that compared to these few little years down here. What hampers us down here? Trials could include sickness, hardship, maybe death. I know we all lose loved ones at times. That hurts. Oh, what glory that'll be when our Jesus will see, and also our loved ones that have gone before us that knew Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, we have to understand, God is serious. He's serious about this life, because these are testing grounds, proving grounds. He, right now, he has got a mark on each one of our backs, and he's going to prove us if we truly are what we claim to be, or what he's called us to be. What will it be? We need to understand that. Now, I found a few scriptures I think is worthy of dealing with. The Christian life is a battleground, not a road of ease, not always a road of pleasure. It's a battleground. Finally, my brethren, and this is in Ephesians 6:10, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Let me ask you a question. How much power do you have? Do you have power to get your way? Power to amass great wealth? Do you have that power? Our power is in the Lord. The power is in his might and not my own. I'm just a stranger, a pilgrim walking through this life, but I'm looking for something better. And you know what? I want each one of y'all to go with me as we head for those pearly gates, as we are received into God's heaven. What a day that will be when our Jesus we will see. That's what he's asking us for. Put on the whole armor of God, he says. See, that tells us we're not capable in ourselves. We need the armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Do you have trouble with that devil? I mean, is it a daily fight? I know it is with me. Things try to creep in, folks. Things try to pull us away from God. We have that thing that hits us. I can do it. I can do it. I can handle it, Lord. You can take the day off. That is a lie of the devil. But we say, I need thee every hour. Every hour I need thee, Lord. The Christian life is not necessarily an easy life. Trials and temptations will come. I don't know if you had a trial or a temptation this week. Good chance you have, because we're flesh. But we have to trust in God. Allow him to make us into what he wants us to be. Our flesh is weak, but our God is strong. He is powerful. He is one to be worshipped. He's one to be drawn to us, and we receive His strength to live the Christian life. Now, verse 7, as we dealt with, our trial of faith being much more precious than of gold or pearls. We don't see it that way. Lord, I don't like to go through those trials, those hurtings, that maybe that sickness. I don't like to go through that. Let me go ahead and say, Peter faced every bit of that. You think he had an easy life? No, he didn't. He was persecuted. Remember, he's locked in prison and was going to be put to death. But his faith in Lord God, in Jesus Christ, brought an angel and brought him out of that prison. That's what God can do. And he can do that for you, and he can do it for me. But we have to let him. There's another verse there that really needs to be dealt with. 2 Timothy 3:12. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. If you live for God, if you let the world know that you're a Christian, you will be persecuted. You won't have the friends maybe that you used to have before you were saved. But look what we have now. We have greater friends. We have Christian friends, church friends. We have friends in high places. And that's because God is in it. Because He wants us to love one another, to uphold one another, to be there for one another in hard times. That's what He wants us to do. So I would ask you right now, do you know Jesus Christ? Have you ever made that commitment to say, Lord Jesus, I've not lived for you. Maybe I'm lost. Maybe I need a Savior. I know we all need a Savior. But right now, I want to make things right with God. So I would ask all those that are tuning in on Facebook, maybe the radio, those seated here, are you sure? Do you have that strong assurance in your heart that is given by the Holy Spirit of God that you truly are a Christian? Oh, I would beg you, folks in the church, don't leave this church building until you know for sure. Those on Facebook, I hope there's a great number out there that's hearing this, because it is important. But I ask those, has there ever been a time that you said, Lord, I feel that conviction in my heart that I'm lost, undone. And right now, Lord, right now at this moment, you've spoken to my heart. You've shown me that I need a Savior. So I would ask you just to pray a prayer. Let me lead you in a prayer. And let's bow our heads. Lord God, I know through the preaching of the word what God's laid on my heart. I know I need a Savior. I know that I failed in a lot of ways in my life, but now I want everything to change. And you've promised in your word, that if we'll ask you, that you will save us. So I ask you right now, as a sinner, come into my heart and save me from my sin. And I know you'll do that. And I pray and ask that in Jesus' name. And let us close in a word of prayer. Thank you, Father, for this day, this time. Thank you for all those that have come today or are listening to us. I pray your blessing upon each and every one of them. Bring them to a thorough understanding of what you will do, what you have done, and that you will guide and direct that life that we might all live for Jesus. And know in our hearts that we're Christians, we're saved. What a joyous thing that is, just to know that I'm saved and washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. We'll praise you for it, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Number 602 is we sing together.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Today you've heard the word preached. You've been told exactly what God expects of you and the experience you can have with Him this day. It can be a whole new beginning. I don't know if everyone in this building is saved. I hope we are. But God has given opportunity. If you prayed that prayer, hallelujah, what a Savior is all we can say.
The world behind me.
Thank you for being here today. We will have a prayer to end our service, and we'll go into our prayer list and on into our business meet. I'm West Brother Bob. If he would close this out in prayer, please.